So wait, let's read the email though, because like
yeah, that's what... we should give a shout out to because it's 3 weeks waiting and we didn't deliver as fast as we should. But then again, he sparked the idea for us to
go do back this like to go back yeah. to the third world treatment thing.
Yeah, it's like yeah, it's been 2 years and we have to check what changed. You know, how are the things different now? And how we do our computing and think stuff. Of make it witty and intelligent. Yeah. Because originally third worldable means, you know, just sticking to the branding of third world Linux. But we have to find like a deeper purpose for it, a meaning.
Yes. Anyway, thanks for buying the time while I looked for the email.
Yeah, I was vamping. That's why I was looking for more adjectives and superlatives. Because my internet connection is not holding up. Oh, well. So, I mean, we're connected, but it's not fast.
Yeah, yeah. That's good enough, I guess. So it's from William, William Perez. He says, hi, Third World Linux.
Hi, William.
Yep. He says, I enjoy your podcast a lot. Additionally,
thank
you
for enjoying it.
Yeah. Additionally, can you review Peppermint 6? I want to hear your opinion. And also, your podcast is mentioned on Linux for the Rest of Us, number 184. Here's the link. Thank you, William. Right, so, thank you, William.
Thank you, William, so much. Yeah. And a shout out to that we were in Linux for the Rest of Us.
Yep.
Which is highly appreciated. And here we are, Peppermint 6.
Exactly, Peppermint 6. So, how do we do this? Right, Peppermint 6. It was released in June, I think. Yeah, around June.
What?
I don't know. I'm just trying to be informative. because earlier while I was talking to the boys, when I was talking to Paolo and stuff, before they started recording Bodega Nights, I was like, okay, so I'm going to be doing a review with AG for Peppermint OS, Peppermint 6. And
I'm pretty sure they have no idea what you just said.
I said, we're going to be doing a distro review.
Peppermint
6, right? And then, the first thing Paolo said was, when was it released?
That's when you're gonna love Ubuntu, because the name, the numbering system of Ubuntu actually makes sense.
Yeah.
Kind of yeah. Ubuntu on that, because you won't know. Well, Peppermint, wait, oh, okay, because I was gonna say, oh, Peppermint 6, maybe because it was released on June, and then you said somewhere in July, and that's where my argument failed.
Well, it's, because it's the 6th version. It's it's based on 1404.2 with a 3.16 kernel. It's based on Lubuntu, so the desktop environment is LXDE.
Yep.
Which makes it light and fluffy.
And sweet. You want to go with the whole Peppermint brand.
Well, what was it, though? Their idea, though, if I remember correctly... when I first heard of Peppermint, their thing was, it's sort of like Linux Mint, only spicier.
That was the original idea, and it was more founded upon, what do you call this? More cloud computing and integration.
And it's still sort of like that. And
it lets you, do what you want with it.
Yeah, well, the thing with...
In that sense,
I might as well get this out of the way first, because like the rest this is going to be gushing about how much I like Peppermint.
Yep. That's why I was like, I was holding back because I'm not sure yet if you liked it.
No, I actually really do. But the thing that didn't really sit well with me when it came to the idea of Peppermint OS was the reliance on Google, right? That's sort of been a, the whole web app
thing. It's a thing. Google is,
You know, we were talking about like the privacy concerns and stuff. Although it's nice to see that they've sort of scaled back on that a little bit. Specifically with, they no longer have Google Photos in by default, I think, right? Like, they used to have, Google Photos as their replacement for a photo app.
Yes.
Right?
Now let me double check what it is. It's
Pixlr.
Well, yeah, Pixlr. And then there's an option to add in, what do you call this? The other graphic tools.
Yeah. They like what was it? Their ICE utility used to be based on Firefox, But yes. Then since Firefox did away with their whole app sort of thing, or their app mode or whatever, they were forced to bring it over to Chrome, or Chromium rather, which, you know, like Google kind of makes me feel just a little bit uncomfortable. But other than that, like, it's a really solid distro.
I permanently installed it on my netbook. And you know, my netbook is to have that special place.
Yeah.
Yeah, right? You know that I just don't install things on there, on my netbook.
And I'm telling you, man, Ubuntu Mate, I've been recommending that to you for so long now.
Yeah, you've been into Mate for, like, the two things you've been pushing me to use on my distro, in my netbook, is the two distros right now is, like, that Peppermint, you've told me, oh, you're gonna like it, you like Google services. Not as much before, not as much anymore. 2 years ago. Now I'm like, I like them, but I'm like, I have to find an alternative for certain things. But, like, I don't mind using Google Docs, and it's like, Peppermint is like, yeah. You know? So I'm having trouble, because I like Linux Lite as well, and I like Peppermint, and I told you, right, that I'm not a big fan of dual booting, blah, blah, blah. So, I have a dual boot now. Because I still don't know if I'm still not 100% sure if I want to keep Peppermint, but I'm loving it. It has the right, you know what I'm telling, the right speed and sexy for the specs I have for my netbook.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Might as well. Let's talk about that. Like, what are we running this distro on?
Yeah. My usual netbook is for old timey listeners. Not old time.
Old timey.
Old timey. Because like it means
for your old timey listeners, eh?
the latest distro that you're about to listen to is this paraphernalia that I'm using for my distro and review. You know, it's they call this.
It's a netbook.
It's a Neo, the netbook, tool for the future. It's called the Neo Basic BC2BL netbook, and this netbook is 3-4 years old now. Imagine that. It's a 3-year-old netbook. It's a Intel Atom processor.
Yeah.
And a whopping speed of 512 MB. And oddly enough, it has 300 gigs of hard drive space.
Wait, so you have 512 megabytes of RAM?
I know, a 1 gigabyte of RAM. What's the 512 MB? I think that's the graphics.
Okay.
The Intel graphics something. And it is really low spec.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
If you compare it to, but at the price point, it was a great buy. It was a great buy for that price point, because I got this for around 9,000 pesos. That's $200 more or less. 200, 250, not even 250. Around $220 at least. So it's a great netbook that I, what?
Wait, let me do the.
No, I'm not good at maths. You can do the maths. I'm not the maths guy.
Yeah, let me. Oh shit, I just bumped my microphone. Oops. wait, let me just take note of that.
Oh.
yeah, but let me vamp while I do the math.
So it was this netbook's been in service for me for years, and I've been using it for writing. This is where I was first recording.
Yeah, it's about $200. Yeah. About $200 at
around,
45.
Yeah, two. Oh, okay, so two around 200.
218.13.
Oh, 220. So I was
more
right
or less.
The mark.
Yeah.
Yeah, which it's a really good buy, because it also came. It came with the Ubuntu 9. No, not 9.
It came with 12.04.
No, not 12.04. It came
11.10?
With 11.10. It came with 11.10.
Okay.
That's what I was telling you about. Like, they didn't even, like, the, I was telling you about that, right? That, why didn't even they try to put 12.04? That was the thing I was telling you about when I got this. And then they didn't even configure the graphics when it came out in the box. Like, they didn't even download the proper driver for the graphics. Like, it didn't come out of the box, and they were touting this as, the company Neo was touting this as a low-end netbook ideal for school or that. But what I was complaining to them about was that, my complaints was, you didn't package it in such a way that it was ready to use.
They should have put Ubuntu Mate on it, or Peppermint, or LXDE.
Yeah.
You know, something LXDE-based, or something XFC-based. Anyway, enough rambling on that.
No, it came, I think, with...
It came with Unity, man. It was straight Ubuntu. Yeah, it was I Unity. Distinctly remember oh. that. It was straight
yeah,
Unity.
Yeah, it came
like,
with Unity.
I mean, oh, like, yeah, you know.
Slow and sluggish, and then at 800 by 600 because they didn't fix the proper, what do you call this? The, and then the wireless drivers are nowhere.
Yes.
Like for something like that, didn't came right out of the box, so I had to configure it, and the first thing I put here was Linux Mint 13 XFCE.
Yeah, I remember that with your gray desktop.
Yeah. Yeah, with a gray desktop, right? And it's really low spec based from the specs I told you about, which I should probably put the link of the specs because we've discussed that in the early episodes.
Right. But, I am
Go ahead.
Right, I am using my brother's old laptop, an Acer Aspire 5500Z, which my brother had when he was in high school. No idea why he like left this computer here, but there we have it. It's got an Intel Pentium M processor, 1.73 gigahertz, which is single core. So this is a little bit this is slower, much slower, I think, than what the average Filipino has, in terms of, you know, a young professional. Right? Single core, like most people that are of that sort of broad C kind of category at least has a Core 2 Duo or something that can run a 64-bit operating system. So this is just me being stubborn. It's got a gig and a half of RAM, and the graphics processor is an Intel 915GM. So this is not a great laptop, but I use it as my daily driver thanks to Linux. Not so much my daily driver as much as like the thing that I keep by my bed. Yeah.
What do you mean this thing you keep by your bed?
Like this is what I watch YouTube videos on. This is, you know.
Oh, okay.
Like I download cases on this thing, that sort of thing. But then I don't bring it out because it can't hold a charge. Like the battery is dead.
Oh, I mean, that's the thing I like about my netbook. It's it could last 6 hours.
Nice.
Well, not anymore. Because it's old and like it has already cycled how many times. I think right now it's just last 4. But it's not like my father's MacBook Pro from 2006, right? That I inherited. Because that only lasts like 20 minutes on battery.
Yeah.
And you can't find replacement batteries anymore. And add to that, I can't... there's also no support now for 10.6 OS X. So, security vulnerabilities.
Yep. So, let's go to our criteria.
Which I can't open right now because...
I have it.
Good.
Prepared, man. Because prior preparation and planning prevents piss-poor performance. Ah. We're sorry to the British people. We have an explicit tag. our history teacher kept on saying that. He was this British dude who used to be in the Hong Kong police force. Anyway. Let's see. Right, so... An intuitive graphic user interface, i.e. a good desktop environment.
Yes.
smooth, a right mix of speed and sexy.
Yes.
Check. A good community. Check. And they have like a nice page.
They have a nice page. Really nice. It was a whole lot better. Because before, I remember it was a spiral pattern lollipop or taffy. I think it's called taffy.
All right.
A peppermint taffy. Oh my God. That's what it's called. Peppermint OS. AG, your realizations.
brainless install. Well, it's pretty much the Ubuntu installer, but what was
It is pretty much the Ubuntu problems. On my grub, it didn't show Linux Lite anymore.
Really?
Yep.
Huh.
So I had to fix that a bit, yeah.
Okay, because I installed go ahead.
And another thing is, during the install, like, during Ubuntu installs, right, you have there, welcome to this distro, and this is our features, and this is what you can do after, this is the things you need, like that. What interested me the most was that, you could customize this, and add the extra packages, say, for photography, for security, for this and that, right? Then just... Choose that based on how I understood it, is choose that package and we'll get everything for you. And now that I have the desktop, for the life of me, And again, I am very stupid when it comes to these things. I can't find where it is. Where would I enable that and whatnot?
Okay.
Is it in the customized looks and feel? And it's not in the, which I really, really like this one, the Peppermint Control Center.
Oh, yeah.
I like that. Because, again, I utilize the netbook to be as efficient as possible. So I always lower down all the graphics, all the whatever fancy things. In Windows, it's the arrow equivalent, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But here, when I just saw, okay, Peppermint Control Center, the first thing I click, desktop effects, disable all effects. Uncheck the enable desktop effects. Like, yeah.
Yeah,
I love
so,
that.
Like the transparencies and stuff, right?
Yeah, all those things. Like, because it's not that. I mean, it's nice because it can make you have the option if you want to. But for me, nope, no desktop fix.
Yeah, yeah.
And I also like the window manager.
Window manager. That's LXDE, though, right? Oh, wait, no. LXDE's window manager is OpenBox.
Yeah. No. This is not OpenBox, right?
It's OpenBox because LXDE OpenBox with stuff on it.
Yeah. The file manager, sorry. Window manager.
Yeah, yeah. I know you're a big fan of OpenBox as well.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of OpenBox as well. So I'm a big fan of a lot of things.
What was the file manager is Nemo.
Yeah.
I know nothing about Nemo. Other than
me too.
That's what they
use. I just like it. Because it shows the space, like, in a bar under, like, think like that. I can resize. Like, this is a lot more intuitive than 10.7, OS X 10.7. Like, I understand everything here.
Well. let's not get into the shortcomings of an inferior operating system.
Hey now.
Shots fired.
Fought shired. Yeah. Okay. But I'm sorry if I'm going to constantly compare it to 10.7. I know I'm insulting the machine I'm recording at right now. It's really great hardware, but the OS is just, oh my God. Such a chore to work with.
Yeah.
How about your take?
Alright, let's see, I struck out customizable, so, like, but then we included it in the show notes, oops. Fast, yes, sustainable, they have 6 versions, good repositories based on Ubuntu, so it's got everything that's Ubuntu, an exhaustive installation process, yeah, I actually have it triple booted with
your Arch.
And with Ubuntu Mate and Antergos. So, like...
Oh my God. That's another distro that... it's gonna gut me. This few weeks is just gonna gut me. Not in the sense that... And not in a good way. This is like a beautiful problem to have. Because there are so many good choices right now.
Yeah.
And I'm looking forward to each and every one of them. And I'm like, what am I gonna use? So I'm pretty sure I'm gonna end up with like 4 distros in my netbook. If Paolo has 7 browsers, I'm gonna have 4 distros. What am I in the mood for today? How about some Arch? Huh, I think Mate would be perfect for this.
Yeah. The exhaustive installation process, it's the Ubuntu installation process. It's everything that you're sort of expected to have. Yeah, it's okay, I guess.
It's cool.
It's normal, you know.
It has become standard, actually.
Yeah, yeah, like, which is...
That's not standard. It has become the baseline of what you expect to be a decent install.
Yeah, yeah, so fair. That's, and it must look good in its default. I'm not a big fan
like the dark
of the...
Thing.
Yeah, yeah, I like the dark thing as well, but I'm not a big fan of the default background.
Yeah, it looks like more honeybees than peppermint, but...
I can see where they're going with it, but
yeah, yeah, yeah. Me too. Like, ooh, grr.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know if our listeners would get that, but at least you did, so I'm happy.
Yeah. And this is really interesting, though. Like, this final criterion that I have that must look good and it's a default. I know that a lot of people out there, and I'm sure I was. A lot of people out there at one point, and in a lot of ways, I guess I am still a lot of people out there. we'll
what is the go on?
Are going to say that it doesn't really matter what it looks like in its default. Like, why are you nitpicking on this? Because what's it? Because it's customizable, right? Like, that's the essence of Linux. And to that, I say you're right. But at the same time, once we start nitpicking on the way that it looks, that means it's an amazingly great system.
Yeah.
Because we can afford to say that, you know, I don't like the default wallpaper.
And the thing is, the thing I don't like was that it's not a fault of the distro. It's more of my user stupidity.
Yeah, and well, you know, I mean, they do have good, you know, desktop back. They do have, like, good backgrounds available.
Other selections, yeah. It's the default. It's just not, you're not a big fan of the default.
Not a big fan of the default. But other than that, like, it's a really good distro. Like, it runs on shit hardware amazingly well.
I'm surprised. I was really surprised by that. Because you remember when we did benchmark tests of different desktops, environments?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The fastest on my system is XFCE, mm-hmm. right? That's why I stuck to XFCE.
Right.
But this LXDE one is amazing. And you've been a fan of LXDE ever since.
So it's like, yeah, yeah.
I really like the right. Jell may be right. It is indeed faster. Like, it is very, very usable. That's what I like about it. It's just that, and now I think it's a lot better than before in that sense that you could choose whether you could opt with the cloud computing or not.
Yeah.
Because before, that was the meat of the system, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, it pretty much was.
Now the philosophy has shifted to, let's do something usable where our user could have the option to put his files wherever he wants. If he likes cloud computing, let's make it easier for said person.
That's always sort of been their philosophy, though. Like, what's it, right? Because their problem with a lot of these cloud... It was a reaction to... What was the name of Google's Chrome OS? It was a reaction to Chrome OS. Because Chrome OS was too cloudy. So, yeah. Like, what Peppermint wanted to do was have the option for the cloud, but still have a full operating system on your machine.
Which, that was like the thing we were espousing. Yeah, I know, Chrome OS can boot up in what, how many seconds? But you can also do that with Arch. But the problem with that is you don't have an operating system where a user can interact with his computer in not a faster manner, but in a very traditional sense. Because even if you look at right now, I just changed the desktop on my Peppermint on my netbook. And looking at it, this could easily replace any XP system anyone is using.
Yeah. Ice. Ice is amazing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I haven't tried Ice.
It's so cool. It's like I have a direct link to our Hangout. Like, I just press on it, it's like, there it is. Although, I don't think this computer is powerful enough to handle it. Like, to handle a bunch of people talking at the same
what
time.
What does SSB stand for, if we're going to get a bit technical on this again?
Single something... Bleh?
Bleh?
Dude, single
actual people are listening to us now. We are now conscious that actual people are listening to us. We kind of have to be, you know, on point in this thing. Single something browser. Shimmer, 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 shimmer. But either way, I have to try this. I haven't tried ICE yet. Because you know what I usually do is I perform my, hey, can I actually do the things I do in a computer and whatnot.
Yeah, yeah.
The most basic things. Yeah, my basic benchmarks. That you already know that.
Yeah. Well, the thing I really like about ICE is it's like the web app, man. Like, it's like, if you run Chromium from the command line and you give it the argument app or something, like, it'll open a Chromium window without your URL bar, without the hamburger menu or whatever. So it's just that. It's a dumb screen or whatever you want to call it. So, like, that's so you do that on the command line or whatever. ICE gives it a graphical user interface and makes it so that it integrates into your menu and stuff.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. I'm just like, also, it's now on my menu. I can just easily click on that thing and it turns it into a web app.
Yeah, that's
Oh, that's going to be amazing. Oh my God. I had to move away from the mic a bit because I was I was spiking because you know me, I like my web apps and oh my God. Oh. I am liking this.
Yeah. And as far as I know, it's the only distribution that actually has this. So if we're looking at, what was that term that you guys use for your marketing thing? The unique selling proposition?
USP.
Whatever that is. This is this particular distro's, like, USP.
That is interesting.
Right? Like, it makes it easier for you to do the, let's have this as a web app
sort of thing. Because I could imagine it now. The entire week I was watching the International.
Yep.
So, which is the Dota 2 tournament. Like, it could have been great if I could, turn that to a web app instead of going to Twitch. Just click on my menu. Click,
and then it opens up to the Twitch. Yeah, that's...
It opens up and then it could have the chat closed already and all those things. And Oh my God.
Yeah.
I'm so happy. Oh man, it's gonna make, oh my God. So I'm just so, like the possibilities are popping in my head because I use so many online applications, not just for work, but it's gonna be amazing.
Site-specific browser there, SSB.
Ah, that's why it has the option of either using Chrome or Chromium or Chrome.
Yeah, I guess.
Uh-huh. Yeah, because it just opened it and it says down there like open in Chromium or open in Chrome and it makes it site specific. I don't know.
a site specific browser is you have a browser specific mm-hmm. to one site.
Ah, okay. It's only for that, and you can't move away to other things.
Yeah, I guess. I mean,
all right.
Site specific browser. Right. So it's like having a bookmark. But then instead of, you know, it takes out an extra step or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's the most amazing thing, I think, about Peppermint. Like, it makes that whole process much easier.
So what else? What else are we thinking about Peppermint? Is it third worldable?
I say yes.
Should we go to that? Okay. So you said yes. I say yes as well. But I especially think that the thing that they said that, oh, you could use this package to, if you want to turn it to photography, for security, for office work. I wish that could be part of the install process instead of actually doing it after.
Yeah.
Like for me, like, okay, we just installed, like, say at your first boot. Okay, you just have, are you going to use this specifically for pictures, for gaming, for office? You want it to be really secure or want to be a bit open or like things like that. That for me is what I wish to add to that. And another category could add, because again, we always think about for educational purposes or government purposes, which is a dream that if we could pull this off in the Philippines, that
Microsoft isn't going to allow it.
Yes. but that's a different story. Is that, say, a government could issue something like to government officials that, or government officers, government workers, that here's a operating system that can easily customize, that we can easily monitor. So I always see it as that, but I think Peppermint would be great. Really, my number one recommendation is if you're using XP still, get Peppermint instead.
Yeah.
Because that's the first initial impression. As soon as I open it, okay, this looks like it can be a direct replacement for those still using XP. And in this country, for the life of me, some of them banks. Like,
yep.
Mostly government officials. Like, I see XP in government official spaces and point of sales machines.
Yeah. Well, you know, going back to what we said though, like, as long as it doesn't touch anything that touches the internet. But, you know. Government offices, better like safe. That's disturbing. Government offices, my God. Yes.
Like, it makes me kind of happy that the Philippine Postal Service in the Pasig office doesn't have computers. You know? They still do it the old-fashioned way. But, which with is
pens
quite
and
weird.
Elbow grease.
Yeah, because it's just quite weird. Because when you go to the Pasig City Hall, that building is high-tech as shit.
Oh, well.
Which is weird, because, you know, I guess different offices, Postal Services, Philippine Post, and the Pasig City Hall, of course, Pasig City taxpayer office, money. It's really swanky, man. That's why I love this city, in a love-hate relationship fashion. But, yeah, I guess that's my recommendation. It is third-worldable. It's easy to jump into it, like, and it's a lot easier to customize, especially for those who like to tinker with their distros.
Yeah.